Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Center for Arts Education's webinar on the arts and the Common Core standards. I'm Jerry James, Director of Teaching and Learning, and I'm here today with David Bilotti, our Director of Communications. Adrian Merrick, our Programs Assistant, is here as well. They will be co-producing the webinar. Before we begin, I want to thank ShareMyLesson.com for inviting us to present at this virtual conference, and our friends at the American Federation of Teachers for introducing us to Share My Lesson 2 years ago. I also want to thank the UFT Teacher Center for helping us develop innovative practices here in New York City. We're going to explore two essential questions. The first is, how can arts teaching and learning support implementation of the Common Core standards? Today's session is going to focus on the Common Core standards for ELA. The second related question is, how can proposed National Core Arts Standards, or NCAS, inform lesson and unit design? For those of you who are not familiar with the National Coalition for Core Arts Standards, here's some context. It's been 20 years since the last full National Arts Standards were defined. The NCAS frameworks were created after looking into best practices around the world and eliciting feedback from the education field. The frameworks are especially relevant to our discussion today because they were created to address demands of 21st century education. The coalition, which includes the College Board, has worked hard to connect grade level art standards with the Common Core standards for ELA and math. After this session, I hope that you'll be inspired to visit the NCAS website, as well as ours. And if you have questions that are not addressed today, feel free to email me, jerry@caenyc.org. Let's linger on the next slide for a few seconds so that you can write down the four creative practices described: imagination, investigation, construction, and reflection. I used this framework to design the interactive art activity that we're going to do together later in the webinar, so please keep it handy. You'll need a few blank sheets of paper as well. Our webinar agenda looks like this: a little background on 21st century teaching and learning, CAE's perspective on the arts and language literacy, four Common Core ELA standards that directly relate to the arts, literacies and practices in the NCAS frameworks, the visual art activity I mentioned, reflections on the activity, and then a question and answer session facilitated by our friends here at ShareMyLesson.com. Before we dive into CAE's relationship with the Common Core, I should clarify that we're talking about a form of arts integration, or what is sometimes called learning in and through the arts. I say this because artistic endeavors develop capacities of understanding that are not always discussed in traditional performance or studio training, what is sometimes called the conservatory model. As arts teachers, we may think, for example, that a student who plays a score all the way through in tune and in rhythm is intelligent and disciplined, and rightly so. If the performance incorporates atypical phrasing or pronounced feeling, all the better. We're likely to describe the work as exceptional. We often forget, however, to ask this developing performer what was involved in getting to that point, or how the understanding acquired might apply to other concerns and tasks. Questions like these shown here make thinking visible. We could ask, what challenges did you encounter? What choices did you make? And what did you learn that might help you accomplish other goals? As we'll see, the dimensions of learning revealed are important to understanding and addressing the Common Core standards. By the way, there's a great book about this approach to classroom work. At CAE, we get requests for robust art programs that also develop reading, writing, listening, and speaking skills. In addition to developing model programs, as you can see here, we study their effectiveness. And we've come to believe that artistic skills and language proficiency develop hand in hand. I'm grateful to Dr. Larry Scripp for introducing us to the term arts plus arts integration. It aptly describes much of what we do in schools, and it definitely applies to what we're going to explore today with regard to implementing the Common Core standards. I'm not talking about the kind of arts integration I experienced in school. Back then, We made still life paintings of food groups, and I guess we learned a little bit about nutrition and a little bit about painting. Like many people, my public education was mostly top-down instruction. It allowed little room for discussion or debate. Arts integration back then usually meant teaching another subject with the arts. In contrast, today's arts integration focuses more on thematic teaching, problem solving, and student-centered inquiry. Yes, we've come to understand that a discrete activity, such as making portraits of famous people, is not going to teach much about social studies. It's taken a while, but arts integration has evolved from a largely teacher-driven model to one that encourages student-driven learning across disciplines. And I think that's where the arts can make the strongest connections to the Common Core. Put another way, how can we as educators encourage connections among different ways of knowing? How can we inspire learners to pursue their own investigations of complex concerns? And how can schools prepare students for the future by emphasizing what David Perkins calls life-worthy learning? In particular, I'm talking about the four C's: creativity, communication, collaboration, and critical thinking. The 21st century also has a new set of three R's. When I was growing up in Virginia, the three R's were reading, writing, and arithmetic. Today's students also need to know how to reflect, research, and revise across disciplines. Here's a second grader's reflection on a trip to the Museum of Modern Art. I'll translate it into adult terms. As you can see, she learned about multiple interpretations. She also learned that a painting is often revised many times before it's finished. Do you remember making something in school, taking it home and parking it on the fridge? That doesn't suffice anymore. Students and teachers alike need to be able to reflect on learning experiences and envision what should happen next. As Webb's depth of knowledge model illustrates, aptitudes such as these are considered to be higher order thinking, the kinds of skills students need in order to succeed in college, careers, and throughout life. The DOK model organizes levels of thinking in clockwise rotation. Let's pause for a minute to discern relatively basic thinking, such as recall and summary, from the more complex operations associated with revising and creating. Now let's look at some tasks that require higher order thinking with arts education in mind. Let's start with level three: support ideas with details and examples. Match voice to purpose and audience. Consider how exploring artists' intentions informs interpretations of their works. Moving to the right column for level four activities: analyze and synthesize information from multiple sources. Here I'll add that contemporary works of art in particular often begin this way. Connect themes across content areas. Well, that's one of the definitions of arts integration I highlighted earlier. Moving up to the top, conduct a research-based arts project and present your findings. Here is a proposal for an original monument created by Gabriella, a pre-service visual art teacher. Students at the School of Visual Arts here in New York City were asked to envision a monument to something they truly cared about. Her project is a tribute to memories and sensory experience. Because imagination and investigation were required to develop a convincing, feasible proposal, the olfactory memory kit melds visual art, neuroscience, social science, and math. Note that a reflection component was incorporated as well. Now let's see what arts plus arts integration can look like in a public school. This assignment combined street photography and plane geometry. After practicing camera angles and other artistic strategies for several weeks, the class agreed on this research question: how can we use digital cameras to find/document geometric shapes in our neighborhood? Here's one student's work. I hope you'll agree that evidence of visual art and math learning can be seen in the five sequential images created. Best part of this for me? Isabel was in the second grade. Yes, kids do critical thinking too. With outcomes such as these in mind, it's hard to imagine challenging artistic work that would not require what Webb describes as strategic and extended thinking. At CAE, we have several big tents that accommodate related ideas. The one I'm talking about today is literacy, or literacies, which, by the way, wasn't a word until recently. That English teachers recognize the importance of multiple literacies is another strong argument for Arts Plus Arts Integration. Because definitions of literacy and its counterpart, oracy, vary across cultures, I'll explain what I mean by artistic literacy. It's more than being able to read, write, and talk about the arts. The intersection of arts and language is more fundamental, and accordingly, it promotes understanding across cultures. If you don't believe this, come to New York City, and I'll show you schools where we work, and you'll see newcomers to our country, for whom English is often not a primary language, profoundly participating in the arts. As one example, let's look at this clip. Unfortunately, as we progress through school, we're likely to become less artistically literate. As adults, the imagination and curiosity that shaped earlier experiences tend to be upstaged by other ambitions and responsibilities. I believe that we become inclined to defer to others. And as the second cartoon suggests, some people actually think the arts are for others and not for themselves. Even if we are connected to the arts professionally, and I'm sure many people tuning in are, there's still room for development in a Common Core kind of way. Maybe we prefer jazz to country music, but we can't explain why. Maybe we're hooked on the plot of Downton Abbey, but never give thought to its architecture, historical context, or the real people who live there. We are likely to be moved by Picasso's masterpiece, Guernica, but maybe we haven't thought about what went into making it. By the way, this is just a fraction of what went into it. For that matter, maybe we haven't given thought to the atrocities that inspired it. There's a whole book about this. Perhaps we perceive Kazimir Malevich's painting in the Museum of Modern Art as a flat design rather than as two forms interacting in space. Maybe we don't know it's based on a theory of art. Maybe we accept its ironic title at face value and walk away dazed and confused. Examples such as these call us to become more artistically literate. The Common Core standards ask us to think of language literacy as a kind of connective tissue among content areas. I would argue that the arts have the potential to be equally, if not more, inclusive, extensive, and expansive. I'm not suggesting that we memorize facts or only offer interdisciplinary studies, but rather that we practice imagination, investigation, construction, and reflection within the arts disciplines and across other disciplines. As educators, we also need to bolster our commitment to the arts in our schools, at work, and at home. By the way, if you're in education, those three words are probably interchangeable. As the educational philosopher Dr. Maxine Green reminds us, the arts are for everyone, not just an elite few. So with some context on 21st century education behind us, I think we are ready to directly approach our first essential question. After exploring it together, I hope you'll agree that connections among the arts become clearer when literacy is a pronounced concern.
Let's look at four ELA anchor standards that address the following concerns.
1, students need to understand content presented in different media and formats. So this, to me, means all the disciplines, and it's certainly a direct connection to the arts and media studies. 2, Different situations require different kinds of vocabulary. As tiers 1 and 2 illustrate, the words we learn in social situations are not necessarily the ones we're going to need throughout school. Tier 2 refers to high-frequency academic words, the ones that are used across disciplines. And these are the words we most need to succeed in school. Analyze is a good example of a Tier 2 word. Tier 3 refers to specialized terms like those in science, biology, law, and yes, the arts. Value means one thing to an investor and something else to a painter. Value means still something else to a photographer, because the process of creating values is very different. And of course, there is slang and jargon unique to every discipline. Kale, which I avoided like the plague growing up, is now a popular ingredient in vegetable juice. But do you know what kale meant to musicians in the jazz age? I would argue that the Common Core standards implore us to approach language more as a medium than as a set of rules and definitions. And what better way to do this kind of work than participating in the arts integrated studies we're exploring today? Now for the two remaining Common Core standards. Students need to be able to engage in collaborations and conversations with diverse partners and clearly express their ideas and claims. What comes to mind here is students talking to each other about masterworks and about their artistic work, both the product and the process. Robust art programs will also provide students with opportunities to interact with arts professionals such as performers, teaching artists, and museum educators. The last anchor standard I'll discuss today focuses on close readings of texts. Let's consider what text means. CAE's definition extends beyond words to include works of music, dance, theater, visual, and media arts, as well as an array of related content and materials. If we stop to think about it, artistic work involves all kinds of texts, scores, images, and all of the related information and narratives associated with the arts. Before we begin our art activity, let's spend some more time on NCAS. Given the tenor of this presentation, you're not going to be surprised that I'm excited about reframing the arts as literacies. In NCAS terms, literacies are what we do in the arts: creating, producing, performing, presenting, responding, and connecting. Creative practices are what we become good at, both within the arts and across disciplines. As noted in the beginning, the National Coalition consciously connects their work to the Common Core. For example, the Common Core standards for ELA refer to reflection 43 times. Now, I think we're ready to begin the art activity. I'm going to focus on weather, or more importantly, how and why artists represent weather in real and symbolic terms. I picked weather because it's something everyone can relate to. Here's a kindergarten student with me in the museum. She's giving a weather report in front of Starry Night. We all regularly use weather to describe our experiences, and here are some examples. He stormed out of the room. It was a whirlwind tour. You're skating on thin ice. Oh, my foggy idea. She has a sunny disposition.
Shall I compare thee to a summer's day? Thou art more lovely and more temperate.
If you made a list of what you would expect to see in paintings that have weather as a feature, what would it include? Let's take some time to write that down. By the way, this is not an exercise that's exclusive to visual art. That just happens to be my background. Certainly, in Shakespeare's The Tempest, the weather is a major feature. Now let's listen to this.
They call it Stormy Monday, but Tuesday's just as bad.
What does Bobby Blue Bland's rendition of Stormy Monday suggest about how and why artists represent the weather? I think we can say that weather is a symbol weather is a metaphor. If we're recalling or imagining artworks about weather, that's one thing. If we're thinking about weather as a larger expression of meaning, we're really talking about metaphor, one of the most powerful uses of any media.
Ain't no sunshine when she's gone. It's not warm when she's away.
By the way, if you want to learn more about metaphors, I suggest this classic book. Now here's the fun part. I want you to think about a weather event in your life. How would you portray it? We've all been caught in a snowstorm or a rainstorm, a squall, something like that. I'd like you to take out a piece of paper right now and just write down what that event was for you. Spend about 45 seconds on this. Now, what's this going to look like as a work of art? What would you do to translate it into visual terms? What would you show? What would you represent? Would you depict the weather conditions? Are you inside or outside? Are you alone? Are you with other people? Is it in the middle of the event or just before, or just after? What do you need to include to represent your experience as a work of art? Let's write all that down. Going beyond the subject matter, let's talk about how you want to portray your experience. Would you use watercolor or oil? Thin paint or thick paint? Will the image be clear or ambiguous, realistic or abstract? Please write some of this down right now. Going on to the next part of this exercise, how would you share this with a colleague? Maybe try turning and talking to that person. If there's no one there with you right now, you can imagine talking to someone else. I'm asking you to discuss more than what happened. I want you to tell your colleague how you're going to express this. In other words, I'm asking you to think like an artist. Let's go one step further. Why don't you work with this partner and take turns portraying your experience as a tableau? Doesn't have to be elaborate, but certainly you can create a frozen image. Here's Eric Pryor, our executive director, shoveling snow. And here he is. I'll let you imagine what he's doing. By the way, that's Jackie Schiffer, our program's coordinator in the back, playing the part of a tree. Here's some other examples. We could add sound effects, we could add dialogue, we could add movement, we could add props. Whatever is required to bring your memory to life. Now, in a classroom situation, we take turns talking about these and backing up our interpretations with evidence of each other's artistic choices. Let's turn to the image that is the focus of this investigation. And I'll start with what I like to call field notes. I'd like you just to draw a rectangle, roughly the proportions of this picture on the screen right now, on a piece of paper. Write down what you notice and where you notice it in the picture. For example, if you write sky, put it at the top. After you've written down some words in different places, can you add descriptors to each word? Adjectives and adverbs. And if you want to go a step further, can you add more adverbs? The goal here is a map, a rich text that also is a graphic representation of what you're experiencing. At CAE, we don't often tell students the title of masterworks because there's more to be learned through the process of them developing their own. In this hypothetical unit of study, however, I'll tell you. This painting is called The Storm. If you don't know that already, it's The Storm. What do you notice? What more do you notice? Write that down. Now let's look at some things that scholars have said. They observed a violent storm, a bending tree, hair blowing in the wind, a spectral quality, women like phantoms. They're covering their ears. and the woman in white separates herself from the crowd. You've probably written down much of this yourself already. And as you can see, this is going a long time. If you turned and shared this with a partner, or if we started to talk about this painting as a group, we would have a long discussion. With each claim, we'd be backing up what we say with what we notice, evidence in the actual painting, or the image of the painting. And as we do this, it's a great opportunity to start writing down research questions. And with research questions, we go even more deeply into the Common Core standards. Maybe you're interested in the house, the location, the artist. Yes, it's Edvard Munch, the same guy who painted the screen. What else are you interested in? Just write that down right now. When I was doing some research on this picture, I stumbled upon the next bit of info, so I'm going to share it with you. And you can tell me how plausible you think it is. A team of astronomers from the University of Texas went to Norway. They checked the weather reports from 1893, the year the painting was made, and they located a journal that belonged to Munch's friend. It described him being there when the documented storm occurred. And with the dates and the times in hand, they were able to surmise that the white dot in the upper right-hand corner of the picture was Arcturus, the second brightest star in the Norwegian sky. I certainly wasn't interested at that point in astronomy or meteorology, but this shows you how independent research can take you to surprising and informative places. From the Common Core perspective, of course, we'd ask students to weigh the plausibility of such a claim. It's not the gospel truth, even though it's a scientific article in a peer-reviewed journal. What do you think? Do you think Munch painted the star? Let me up the ante a bit. There are conflicting accounts, and some claim that Munch was in Paris at the time. This could go on and on, but in the classroom, the ultimate goals of an exercise like this would be, perhaps, making a painting, or making a scene, or a poem about a weather event based on personal experience. Another goal in the classroom would be to help students learn how to develop research questions and pursue their own interests and come back and present their findings. Today, we have a third goal, which is to show how the frameworks that we've been talking about, the NCAS frameworks, can inform the design of an activity such as the one we just did. So I'm going to put up the sequence we went through. It's right here now. You can see it. And then here's the sequence compared to the NCAS framework. As we come to the close of our session, I'd like you to think about questions you might have, what we can help you with here at CAE, and please email Jerry@CAENYC. David@CAENYC or Adrian@CAENYC.org. Thanks for tuning in.